First, what are we going to learn today? We're, of course, going to go back and not complete, but complete a little bit more of the DNA to RNA to proteins, the central dogma of molecular biology. And we'll pretty quickly see that we need something called Boltzmann's equation, which relates delta E at a finite temperature as to which is the most likely of states to occur. That will be directly relevant for DNA hybridization. Hybridization means the two strands come together or to unhybridize. And also, surprisingly enough, it relates to why Mount Everest is really tough to climb. Does anybody come from a place in this country or another country where you have mountains? I mean, I know this is a strange concept living in Illinois where things are very flat. Yeah. Go ahead.
What should I say?
I don't know. What should you say? Where are you from? What mountains are there? And have you climbed any of them?
Well, I come from Vermont, like north part of Vermont. So there was a green region in the north, which basically located in the south. There was like the highest mountain in the country. I don't understand foot. So it's like 5,600 meters.
Okay.
And it's called Mount Damolai.
Okay.
Is it quite tough one?
Have you climbed it?
Well, I wish I could, but
5,600 meters. Okay, for those of us who are mentally challenged, what is this about in feet?
1,000.
How are you doing it?
Ah.
Aha. So some of us are a little mentally, you know, whatever. Okay, so that's 15,000 plus 18,000. So that's okay. Has anybody climbed a mountain that high? No, because in this country, the highest mountain is what? Who's from California? Nobody's from California. Wow. There they have about 14,000 foot mountains. Okay, that's probably not why you came here. Anyways, so we're going to talk about some Mount Everest. And then we're going to talk about the entropy, the degree of disorder. And actually, it turns out that will come in a lot in their calculations. And we'll find that the equipartition, Boltzmann equipartition law, isn't satisfactory because it doesn't take into account the entropy. So in order to take that into account, we have to do a calculation based on the free energy. And we'll talk about how that's related to delta E and delta S. And also, we'll talk about protein and enzymes. And we'll talk about equilibrium and kinetics associated with that. And these, in fact, will be related to the previous ones. And in particular, equilibrium and kinetics. Who likes sugar? I used to not like it, but I like it now. In particular, chocolate. Yeah, Who likes dark chocolate versus light milk chocolate? Dark chocolate? Yeah, you guys, forget it. Who's in milk chocolate? Yeah, you get an A. Anyways, we'll talk about sugar and why you can get so much energy out of it, and in particular, why it's stable, but yet you can get so much energy out of it. We'll talk about RNA splicing and why you're different than a little tiny worm. There's a tiny worm called C. elegans. C is some abbreviation for some long word. And it's about a millimeter long. And it turns out that the number of genes in C. elegans is about equal to the number of genes in you. Yet, somehow, I think it's fair to say, you know, you and we are more complex than this little worm. Why is that? And we'll understand it. Okay, quick announcements. This is serious. The lectures are videotaped for, I don't know, some NSF thing or something like that. And it's voluntary. I mean, I like it because, you know. But in general, the videotape, it's on me. It is not on you. However, you cannot be recognized or anything like that. Seriously, this is serious. If there's some reason that you feel like you might get in trouble or whatever, and so you don't want to be recognized, you should not be recognized in video. In audio, you also will not be recognized. However, if there's any problem, what you do is fill out at the end of the evaluation, says, you know, there's a problem, and we'll talk. Okay? So you don't have any excuses not to come. Oh, okay? Okay. Okay. Questions. You had many excellent questions about what I said in the first lecture, but I hate to give you answers. I really do. So we'll talk about it more today. And what is the main thing that I'm going to do? I'm not going to give you the answers. Or, okay, maybe we'll talk about it later. I'll make up homework problems. And that's what I do. You will have several new homeworks, problems, because of your questions. And I'll give you homework today, and it'll be due in 1 week from today, next Thursday. Also, next Tuesday, what do we have in class, at the beginning of class? Hey, have a quiz. And you guys know exactly what it is, because I've given it to you. And you need to read about delta G associated with your reading. Okay, your comments. Geckos are the most popular. All right, let's hear it for gecko. So I found out some interesting things where you go to Fairy Pets and Furry Pets and More. And so these are some of the interesting things. Nearly all geckos lack eyelids, with a weird family, who actually have movable eyelids. The rest are unable to blink and simply have a transparent membrane which they clean by licking with their tongues. Most species of geckos are nocturnal and have excellent night vision. They have a lens in each iris that widens in the dark in order to let in more light. Also, their eyes are about 350 times more sensitive to light than the eye of a human. If you want to know the truth, I have a little bit of difficulty with this, because later on, we'll discuss vision. And the question is, what if, you know, you can think of light either as like a continuous wave or photons? The question is, how many photons can you see? And the answer is pretty much, it's borderline, you can see a single photon. And we'll actually discuss why that is. So 350 times more sensitive, I don't know. Okay, just to relate it back to what you learned, also, it has only been discovered in recent years that something called phospholipids, a fatty acid, remember we talked about lipids, that is naturally produced by the gecko, helps with its ability to adhere its feet to the surface, as well as something called, I don't know, actually, as well as something called van der Waals interactions. Okay? Okay, so a whole bunch of questions you had later, homework. Oh, by the way, you did say some nice things. Okay, this is a failing on my part. This person write, please finish the class on time because I have a class right after it. Okay, you're right. It's a problem that I have. 5 minutes before the bell rings. Bell, I don't, is there a bell here?
No.
No, okay. Well, that's a good excuse. 5 minutes before the end, somebody raised their hand and said, hey, it's 5 minutes, because at that point, you should be doing your evaluation. Okay. Interesting class so far. Also, you should bring in your dog. She's kind of shy, so it might be, eventually I'll bring her in. My wife would get a thrill out of this. You're a very funny guy. Somehow she doesn't think that. I really like the colloquial and open nature of the class, good. I'm very curious about how physics can be applied to make these topics. You'll actually see that today. An entertaining lecture. Okay. Okay, one thing is I want to review the van der Waals interaction as opposed to covalent, ionic, or hydrogen bonds. What we have is we have a neutral atom, the plus charge is centered around the nucleus, very small. The minus charges are in general floating sort of everywhere. And in general, it is likely to be on this side and to be on this side. However, it can form a temporary dipole, that is, where the minus is over here and the plus is over here, okay? Now, what if that molecule forms its temporary dipole? The next atom, if it's close, will see a little dipole, a plus or minus. So this guy over here, it will tend to put its plus over here and attract over here, and its minus over here and attract over here. Not the other way. So basically what you have is you have original temporary dipole and it induces a dipole over here. And that is called the van der Waals interaction. And it's very low, very little energy. But it does happen. And if you have enough of them, it can add up to real forces. So like you have, you know, the gecko and stuff like that. Isn't that pretty cool? Anyways, so what you're going to do in the homework is just revisit the issue of and xenon, and you're going to look at the strength of the interaction, depends on the size of the atom and so forth. Okay? So that's good. Okay, this is a reminder of what the quiz next Tuesday. Okay. Now we start for real. The central dogma of molecular biology, start with DNA, go to RNA, go to proteins. By the way, somebody asked about, well, they had heard that the original species that we all grew out of was probably RNA, not DNA. And the truth is, that's true. And we'll see as how life has changed. But aside from that, DNA to RNA to protein. DNA is in the nucleus. It's double-stranded to keep it happy, though occasionally it needs to open up. When it opens up, it makes RNA a single-stranded form of this. The RNA gets made, gets out of the nucleus. That's generally called messenger RNA because it sends a message out here. And it finds this ribosome, which is both protein and RNA, actually. And the ribosome goes and reads the sequence along the RNA and makes amino acids. Okay, so the DNA to RNA, you have double-stranded. It comes unzipped. Each one, this is three hydrogen bonds, that's two hydrogen bonds. There's a question as to what the difference does that make. What do you think? Yes?
The GC bonds are stronger.
The GC bonds are stronger, that's correct, than the AT bonds. So what if you have to pack the DNA, for example? Let's say you just happen to have a meter worth of DNA, and you need to compact it into a few microns. Where do you think you're going to bend the DNA? Yeah?
AT accumulation sites.
Yeah, and sites that have a lot of ATs as opposed to GCs. And we'll go and study that. Okay, so it gets single-stranded and then it makes a copy of itself. And that where there's a G, then there's a C, where there's a T, there's an A. And then, in fact, this is the sequence that, like, say, C-A-U. Ooh, wait. It's U. What is U?
Uracil.
Uracil. What's uracil?
It's the T equivalent in RNA.
It's equivalent. That's right. And DNA, you have A, C, G, and, well, T. With RNA, wherever there's wherever there's an A, the complementary complementary base pair is U instead of T. That may seem like a very small difference, but that is one of the major reasons that you have RNA instead of DNA. And again, we'll go over that. Okay, now we have to have some way of converting this sequence in the RNA into amino acids. That's what the ribosome does. So in this case, it takes a codon, it codes. It takes three bases and converts that into a single amino acid. And depending on what the sequence is, for example, if it happens to be C-A-T-A-U, sorry, it's going to make one type of amino acid. And then if it does U-G-C, it takes it and makes another amino acid, the ribosome does. And then what it does is it hooks the histidine to the cysteine. And then, depending on this, it hooks it to a glycine and so forth, and goes and makes an enormous variety. Each protein is a little bit differently. Why is a codon three amino acids? Why is a codon three base pairs?
Because two would be too few.
Two would be too few. Why is that? No, you've answered already. Yes.
Because we have like 20 typical of amino acids, so if we only have two, they will be enough. They will overlap. So.
Good. They'll overlap. Why do they overlap? Or
because if we have two, we only have 16 possibilities.
Why?
Because the first one it has four options, and the second one.
Right, so that's 16. Mm-hmm. So if you have three of them, then you have how many amino acids, possibly?
You will have 64.
64, 4 times 4 times 4. Okay, so you have, that's great. It's exactly right. Okay, so you have 64 possible amino acids. And in fact, there are, well, 20 or 21, we'll actually see. I said 21, people said, no, you're full of it, that in fact, there's only 20. I'm not sure. We'll see. Okay, so what does it mean? In fact, in truth, you could have 64, but yes?
I was just going to say the genetic code is redundant, that's why there's not 64.
The genetic code is redundant. So if you have UUU or UUC, either one, it will make what is called a phenylalanine. Okay? If it's CU, and then no matter what the third base pair is, it forms leucine. And here, if it's CA, well, if the last one is U or C, it forms a histidine. However, if it's CA and the last one is A or G, it forms a, what's GLN?
Glutamine.
Okay, good. So if this was a biochemistry course, you'd have to know that. You don't have to know that. I'll give you it. Okay. Now, so let's say you have a big, huge, long string, and you need to know where the start of making a protein is, right? Okay, so what you do is you look around and you say, oh, if you have AUG, that means it's a start sequence. So what you can do is, for example, you can sequence your entire DNA, like 3 billion bases. I mean, this is absolutely amazing. This is what, you know, the Human Genome Project that started at NIH was all about. And the first one, I think, cost like $100 million. That means pretty much. Do you know with NIH whose DNA they originally made? And of course they make the DNA, and therefore they know the RNA and so forth.
Watson.
What's that?
Watson.
Yes, as in Watson and Crick. He didn't tell anyone that it was his, but whatever. In fact, there was a competition between two different types, the types of sequencing. Do you remember who the other guy was? Who?
Craig Venter.
Right, oh man. Craig Venter, who is the, or Venter or something like that, who is the head of the alternative ones. I mean, these guys don't have big egos or anything. Anyways, so what you can do is you can look at the DNA and see, okay, here's a start site. And wait, you need to stop, because you know where to start and where to stop. You look and, oh, there's UAA and UAG and UGA. All of these are stop codons. So you have a start and you have a stop. So that's one, effectively, we'll call it one protein. So you can look at your entire DNA and get a sense of how many proteins, different proteins, there are. Okay, and again, the stretch of DNA or RNA is generally called a gene. So what they did is they counted them up. And much to everyone's surprise, there was very few of them. There was about 20, 21,000, maybe 23,000 genes. That's how many you had. And in fact, they went and did different sequences of monkeys and cauliflower and worms. And amazingly enough, they found that the worm had basically the same amount. Anybody know what organism has more than us? Hmm? A horse? I don't know. A grape. A grape has like 35,000. So just think when you're eating grapes or you're having some wine. I don't know. Yeah?
35,000 of what?
Genes. Although we're going to see a little bit more how the genes and the number of proteins, it turns out there isn't a one-to-one correspondence. You have one gene and one protein. Life is more complicated. Okay. Oh, okay. So wait. So whether we have 20 or 21 different amino acids, so the difference between the amino acids, they all look like this. They have a carboxyl, COOH, here. Then they have one carbon here. And the other, they have an amine, the NH3, or depending on what the pH is. This hydrogen is sometimes gone, and that's COH. And the hydrogen is over here. And the difference between them is in this R group. The R is just a general term for some sort of group. And it turns out that there is 20 or 21. OK, so honestly, I don't know. Let's count them.
Just about the structure of amino acids, why is the NH, the one instead of having an amine and has an NH3, why is that also relative?
It's just because it turns out its reactivity depends on whether it's NH2 or NH3. And it's a function of the pH. And by controlling the pH, you can control whether it's active or not.
Okay.
That's it. Okay, so shall we do it? Okay, so how about we want to count? Okay, so.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine,
18. Hey, I was right. Apparently there's 21. I don't know who thought that there was 20. What?
There's a repeat. Yeah, there's
an
repeat.
RG scared. Wait, not so fast. What?
So you counted ARG twice.
And then below it.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, you skipped Met.
Oh, okay. So there's 20. Oh, I skipped Met, the original one. I'll actually go back to that. So we went to 20, and now we're back to 21. And then what?
SCR.
SCR. That's called serine. And that is?
Between the R. Above the RG over there on the far right.
Between the R's.
Oh, Okay, we're down to 20. Uh-oh. And?
Stop
is actually, it turns out it just says stop. Don't add anything. Whoa. Okay. I'm sorry, there's only 20. I didn't know. Okay, by the way, when the start, it says, you know, okay, start to the right, says to the ribosome, start producing some protein. It, in general, the start also means that it puts a what's called a methionine in there. Often the methionine is later chopped out, but you know, that's just a minor point. Okay. And so when the amino acids form, they form and then they react together by this COH and this NH3 coming and reacting and kicking out of water. And we'll talk about this. Yes?
If we don't count the stop, why do we count the start?
Just because it happens to be the start also codes for a methionine.
Even though it's stopped later?
In general, yes, even though it is. Yes?
If there's a start after a start, I think it just stays there. If there's no stop before the second start, it's just going to code the methionine.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's like an AUG and then like somewhere in between that start codon and the stop codon, there's another AUG, then the methionine will stay in.
Yeah. Is there any other questions? And we'll talk about the energetics of this reaction as to which is more likely, this or this. Okay, so I'll change that to 20 amino acids. And this is, the R group is, it can be, you know, over here, whatever. And in general, the R group, you can classify that. Yes, Joshua. Josh.
You should count them here too, because here they're 21.
Whoa, he's really fast. Really?
Yeah, there's a selenomethionine.
Selenomethionine. So, what do you know what's going on?
No. So, like, this is only one of many cases where bacteria and other things will use alternative amino acid forms that you just don't see in humans.
Ah. And you don't see selenomethionine?
I think selenomethionine, like, we use it occasionally. There's all kinds of alternative amino acids that are post-translationally modified.
Okay, so we're sort of back in the 21. Okay, and in general, you'll find that occasionally they're uncharged, or they're positively charged, or they're negatively charged, and that will actually make a difference in terms of where they are most likely to be. Because after the amino acid gets all strung together, then they fold. And they're folding, remember, in water? And water tends to be what? Very polar or very nonpolar?
Polar.
Very polar. Therefore, if you have a polar molecule, a polar side group, like a plus charge or minus charge, it's going to tend to want to be towards the outside or towards the inside?
Outside.
Towards the outside. And then towards the inside, you're going to get those groups that are more hydrophobic. And that's, in fact, one of the ways in which the protein folds. And it's when it folds that it is truly active. Okay? Okay. Now we're talked about what its primary function, which ones they are. They can fold up into two general classes. One is a secondary structure, and that is it can form a helix or it can form what is called a beta sheet, you know, which sort of looks like that, which actually tends to have a lot of hydrogen bonding between one amino acid and another. Then in general, it forms a tertiary, that is its three-dimensional structure. And then what happens is a protein actually in general is one polypeptide. That poly means one string. Occasionally, in fact, you can have two strings or two genes that make up the polypeptide. So it can form in a quaternary structure. Okay? So that's why a gene, literally, it means codes for a polypeptide, not for a protein, because some proteins are, in fact, many polypeptides. Okay, so we want to understand the DNA, in general, we want to understand when the DNA will unzip and when it'll stay zipped. For this, we're going to need what is called the Boltzmann constant, because the fact that it wants to stay zipped, it's because every time it stays zipped, it either gets two hydrogen bonds or three hydrogen bonds. The more energetic they are, the more likely they are to react. And if they come apart, they come apart. So what if you have a really short piece of DNA, certain probability, or a really long piece of DNA? There's another probability. And in order to understand this, we have to know what is the Boltzmann factor. Let me just have a show of hands. How many of you have heard of the Boltzmann factor? Okay, woo! Okay. We're just going to basically review it very quickly, and I'll give you some homework problems on it. Okay, so let's say you have two states. One is bound and one is unbound, for example. And you're at temperature T. If T is 0 degrees Kelvin, what proportion of particles will be in state E1 and what proportion will be in state E0? Okay. What's your name?
Dan,
okay, that's it. So I want to have someone who's not answered before. Come on. So no, you've answered. Have you answered yet?
Not today,
but no, never. Never, ever, ever. Ah, there we go. What is your name?
Angus.
Okay.
There will be an E0.
There will be no E0.
There will all be an E0.
Oh, there will all be an E0. So, excuse me. Are you from Britain?
Yeah.
Oh, British accents are really fantastic. Notice, actually, this is an aside. I could tell, sort of, that he was from Britain and not from South Africa and not from Australia. I mean, that's pretty sophisticated. I have a friend who's from London. Back me up on this. And he can tell not only that the person is from Britain, but is actually from London. And get this, he can actually tell with high probability as to the block that where he comes from in London. Okay.
I'm not from London, but I can do like areas of London.
Yeah, actually, you sound like you're actually from Australia, but you're not. Well, I'm not from Britain or Australia, so I can't tell the difference, but my friend could. Anyways, okay. The all the molecules will be in state E0. And why is that? How come?
Because they already have like 0.2.
Yeah, there's no energy to kick them up. I mean, ordinarily, at finite temperature, you have molecules which are bashing around and occasionally will hit it and give it. Okay. So we have this. Okay. Now, if T is greater than zero, so that means, you know, you have certain molecules, occasionally will hit the molecule and get it into state E1. So what is that factor? Who knows? Yes? Exponential form, yes, it does. It, in fact, this is just it. The probability of being in some state E sub I is some constant times e to the minus E sub I over kT. There it is again. So what's this constant equal to? Well, it's actually pretty easy in that you know the molecule exists somewhere. So the sum of the probabilities must equal to 1, right? So if you take the sum of both sides, you get this constant is equal to 1 over the sum. And that is in general called 1 over z, where z is known as the partition function. Okay, so the P sub E is equal to 1 over Z times E to the minus E sub I over KT. Okay, so let's talk about a two-state system. The probability is 1 over Z, E to the minus E sub I over KT. What is P sub E1? Okay, you have 1.5 minutes. It's 90 seconds. Go talk about it with the person next to you and give me the answer for two-state system. Okay, let's go.
Should be like an equation.
Right, right. Like since you don't know what E0 is.
Just like put E1 in the E sub I.
That's right. For state 0 and state 1. That's right. Absolutely. So do it. Yeah. So the probability of being in state E1, I haven't told you what E0 is and what E1 is, but just do it as a function of E0 and E1. Okay, go ahead, you've got 20 more seconds. Okay, you got 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. Who wants to tell me what it is? Yeah, but you know already. Somebody who's... Oh, right. Hey, you're a new person.
No, I'm still asking.
No, no,
New person, yes.
Yeah, new as in new to answering the questions. I like it. Okay, go ahead.
E to the negative E1 over KT divided by the sum of E to the negative E0 over KT plus E to the negative E1 over KT.
Excellent. Is E1, E1 over Z, which is the probability of all of them, which in, for two states is this, plus this. Very good. Okay, let's... There we go. And if you want to get a little fancier, divide both side by this, and you have 1 over 1 plus E1 minus E0. Okay? Okay, now we're going to give an example. A thermal fluctuation. Finite probability of being at temperature H. That is, you have a ball. Maybe it's a big ball. Maybe it's a really small ball. And there's some probability that it'll be at your feet and some probability that, you know, they'll be at your eyes or maybe your nose. Think about this with Mount Everest. Okay, so what is the probability of being at height H? What is the energy? MGH. Good. So you have energy of MGH at zero, we call it H naught is zero. And so the energy is mg times h, which we'll call in meters. Okay? So now we do the Boltzmann. The probability at being at h versus being at zero. So this is like 1 over z times e to the minus m, or EH over KT, and this is 1 over Z times E to the minus 0 over KT. So actually, the 1 over Z actually cancels out. Okay? So that means E to the minus MGH over KT. But sometimes I use K, sometimes K sub B. It's the same thing. Okay?
Can you keep that up?
Yeah. Although again, these slides are available to you. Okay. So, as the ball gets bigger, the probability of being at a certain height goes up or down? Goes down. That's because you have a big ball, which is really massive. You know, the chances of it getting a fluctuation at temperature T and, you know, zooming up to here is pretty small, right? Now, what about, okay, so it's now we're going to have a small ball. Maybe this height is, the mass is something like the mass of an oxygen, O2. Then what's the probability of it being at, let's say, your nose height compared to this? What if you're, well, you can be in Iran at 5,600 meters, or you can be at Mount Everest about 9,000 meters. Compared to the sea level, the probability that there's going to be oxygen up here is going to be a heck of a lot less. In fact, you're going to calculate how much less it is. And actually, anything above, I think it's 24,000 feet, is called the death zone. Why do you think it's called that? There's not enough oxygen. Therefore, anybody with any sense climbs with bottled oxygen. Though there is one person, Reinhard Hart Messner, who managed to go up it without any oxygen at all. He did it in a day. Or if you're what is called a member of the Sherpas, you have a mutation such that you can get by on very little oxygen. And so they're amazing out climbing. Okay? So I thought that was kind of cool. Now, climbing at Mount Everest is interesting, and maybe more interesting than being in this class. But we were talking about, in terms of this class, being zipped or being unzipped. And then I'm going to give you, as a homework problem, the probability of it being zipped and probability of being unzipped. It depends on the number of bonds there are. Oh no. Not, close your eyes. Everybody, close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close them. Gosh. Okay. So, anyway, come on. You open them. Jeez. I mean, normally I'm trying to keep your eyes open. Okay. And you'll calculate what the probabilities are. And I'll go and modify this so when you see it, you can't tell. Okay, the problem with this previous calculation is it looked at the Boltzmann constant. It looked at the energy in relative units, the energy divided by kT. But that's not all there is. That's because there's something called entropy. What is entropy? Who can tell me?
The micro disorder.
The micro disorder of something. So what does that mean? You're right. What does that mean? Come on. Yes, Katie. Hold on. You're Katie. What is your name?
Brittany.
Yeah. Okay, I should know that. Come up to me afterwards, how I know you.
There we go.
Another course that I took that she took it. Excellent, thank you. Yes, go ahead, Katie.
Kind of how many, something can have many forms and some kind of in the same state, like, I guess the best explanation I've ever heard is, like, a piano can only be a piano one way, but, like, if you chop it up or something, you have a pile of wood chips and you mix it up, you still have a pile of wood chips that has more entropy.
Very good. That essentially, you can have a series of states, and they all have the same energy. Okay, I'll give you an example here. Here. Isn't this kind of cute? So they have the rabbit over here. Hold on, let me. There we go. One rabbit, few rabbits, whatever. So maybe there's only one state for being here, but the rabbit, there's another series of states where the energy of it being over here is a little bit more. And not only that there's just one state and one state and one state, but maybe that there's several states. All of these have the same energy, though it's different than this, and it's different than this, and it's different than this. And what we have to do is we have to take into account the fact that there's this degeneracy. And that is exactly what entropy is all about. What we do is we take the Boltzmann constant, e to the minus e zero over kt, and then we take the Boltzmann constant still, e to the minus e1 or delta e1 over kt, but then plus e to the minus delta e1 plus this, so that, because it's equally likely to be in any of these microstates. Okay? And now, so this is just the Boltzmann constant. And you see, this is a little bit off, you see in general here there's one energy level, here's another energy level, here's, that's all without degeneracy. Then with the degeneracy, we have, whoops, oh yeah, at energy E0, there's two states. At energy E equal 1, there's three states. Energy equal 2, or 2 times epsilon, there's two states, etc. So instead of doing 1 over z e to the minus ei over kt, what we're doing is we're going to take into account this degeneracy, and so the probability of it being in energy E sub I will be equal to just 2 times E to the minus E over minus 0 plus 3 times this plus etc. Okay? So the probability just more generally looks like W sub I over Z times E to the minus EI over KT. Okay, so here we've actually gotten it. Okay? So that's okay. So now the probability of finding it with energy E sub I with a multiplicity factor is we're going to do a very simple mathematical trick. We're going to say Wi is equal to the exponential of the natural logarithm of E W sub I. That, everybody see this? This is true, right? Okay. Then we're going to say here W sub E is 1 over Z times e to the minus e sub I over kt minus k times t times the logarithm over kt. Right? All I've done is a simple mathematical trick. Now you actually notice that the probability looks like this thing over kt. And let's define, whoops, the entropy as something, some k times the logarithm of the number of these microstates at energy E sub I. Then the probability looks like 1 over z times e to the this thing, where we substituted in for s, the entropy, which let's define this as another factor called the Helmholtz free energy. And it turns out, so this is it. We've accounted for both the energy and the entropy of a particular state. So like when you have the DNA, it's zipped. Its entropy is basically 1. That is the number of states W sub I is equal to 1. It's zipped. The logarithm of 1 is what? 0. So the entropy is 0. Now it starts to come apart. The entropy, it turns out, is not then 0, because it could be, well, let's say it's come completely apart. Then you have many of these microstates. It could be like this, or it could be like this, or, you know, it could be like that, and so forth. So we have to take into account the entropy. But once we've done that, we're going to be all set. Yes?
She's asking if that is if the KBT is of the exponent, or dividing the whole and whole exponent.
Is everything to the right of EXP?
Yeah.
If S is equal to KBT times that KB over KB, they cancel out. So you want to define it as KB times the natural logarithm of the number of states. And it turns out, whether you've included this KB or not, it's actually historically that you include it in the definition of entropy. Okay, so basically what we have is, this is called the Helmholtz free energy, and it turns out that it's actually the same thing as the Gibbs free energy for biochemical reactions. Because what you have is, ordinarily you have E minus TS. Sometimes actually there's a change in the internal energy, that you have a certain pressure and the volume changes. Or you have a certain volume and the pressure changes. In the case of biochemical reactions, they all happen in solution. So P, the pressure, is 1 atmosphere. You can have a certain reaction where you do actually have a big change in volume, namely, like if you have an explosion, you know, before and then after, there's a big change in volume. But we don't have to worry about that. So it turns out you use the term enthalpy as the energy plus PV. And again, you basically don't have to worry about that. So the Helmholtz free energy is E minus TS. The Gibbs free energy is H minus TS. And in general, people are always talking about this. Yes?
What do we define to be energy in this situation? Is it the same thing that we saw as U back in physics 213, internal energy of the system?
Yes, I believe so. That's right. Okay, so the bottom line is, whenever you usually use E, use G, and entropy is taken care of. Okay. We have 10 more minutes. Just, I want to get through a little of this. Okay, now we have two states, A and B. A has some energy level, and B has some energy level, and there are also different number of microstates. The entropy may be different or not. So, what's the probability of, if you have A and B together, they can interconvert because they're at finite temperature. So the probability of being in B goes like 1 over E, E to the minus G sub B over KT, taking account both the entropy and the energy. The probability of being in A looks like this. The ratio is like B over A. That's often called the equilibrium ratio. And that looks like this over this, which is this, or which is this, where delta G is, oh, that one of this should be G sub B. Okay? So this tells you, if you look and you have some energetic and some free energy, you can tell at equilibrium how much is in A versus in B. Now, okay, so the equilibrium is E minus delta G over KT, or you can solve for delta G is equal to the logarithm and then multiply by KT. Delta G is minus KT ln of the equilibrium constant. So if you can measure how much in a solution is A and B, you'll get the equilibrium constant and you can figure out what the difference in delta G is. And not surprisingly, guess who's going to have to do this? Don't find that funny, huh? Okay. And what about if you have A going to B plus C? The equilibrium constant looks like it's going to be like B times C over A. And but how do you figure out that in terms of delta G? Let's see. Who's going to calculate that? You're all asleep. You'll wake up. Okay? Now, last thing. This tells about equilibrium. It tells us nothing about kinetics. That is, you pop something into solution and you have A and B, and over the long time, there'll be a certain equilibrium between A and B, but it tells you nothing about how fast this occurs. Maybe it happens in a second, maybe it happens in a year, maybe it happens in 10,000 years. That's important. Now, how do we relate these things? And this is where proteins come at, play an incredibly crucial role. Let's say you have a substrate, A is here, and B is here. This looks like the free energy. So in this case, this is higher energy than this. It turns out, to go from here to here, you will have to go through a transition state, which in general will be a little bit higher than either of those. And if the energy, you know, the solvent molecules are bashing around, it'll sort of go up here and up here. And at some point, you'll be right here, and the probability goes 50% this way and 50% that way. That is what the kinetics are for. So think of this in terms of sugar molecules. Here you have the sugar molecule, which is a big thing, and you're going to break it up into a bunch of smaller molecules, which are like here. And that difference in energy is what? It's like, yeah, you know, you get the big rush. Okay? But in general, that sugar, you know, big long biopolymer, well, yes, it has a tremendous amount of energy in it, but it doesn't mean that the energy is going to be available to you. But actually, if you eat it and it goes into your stomach and there's lots of acid in your stomach, then, in fact, there will be enough to make it over the transition point. Okay? And we could have the other reaction. We can have low energy going into high energy. Again, with some activation energy. Now, these are various terms. How come this reaction will occur?
Enzymes.
If the difference in this and this is such that, you know, everything is like KT, then it'll naturally happen. However, if not, you know, you often in your body, you need to take some reactants and into some products. And actually, there's two ways of doing it. In general, what you do is you borrow a little bit of the free energy from something else. And it takes that energy and couples it into it such that, in total, the product will be down here. So it's like the product of, you know, some big macromolecule that you have to make, plus the energy that you've taken from it is such that the reaction will go. Either that, that we've all said. Also, if you have something like this, the energy, the transition state energy is very, very high. What happens is if you add another enzyme or add an enzyme into it, what the enzyme does is it changes neither the reactants nor the product, but actually can lower this transition state energy. And that is what proteins generally can do. And I'll say that long, long time ago, RNA could do this also. So you didn't actually need proteins at all back then. In fact, it turns out that in your body, there is vestiges left over from this RNA that existed a few billion years ago. It's amazing. But actually, and I'll get into this more detail later, the ribosome consists of both proteins but also RNA. And the ribosome's job is to go from RNA to proteins. And it does this basically by an RNA-mediated catalysis. That was an awful lot. We'll get that later. Okay, and so this, in the 2 minutes I have left, is how you break down a sugar molecule. Up there is you have sugar polysaccharides. You have a molecule, and you want to break it in here. And this energy is going to be you're going to actually get a lot of energy out of it. But in fact, the transition temperature, or the transition energy, is a lot. So again, you don't normally have this. It's, you have enzymes, or you actually can change the energetics by altering the pH, for example. And in your stomach, you have a lot of low pH. Okay, so I think I have had time. I think I'll give this somewhat as a background. Okay.